Welcome.
Thank you, Mercedes, and thank you, all of you, all of the organizers, Jacopo, Matteo, Silvia, for this nice and interesting workshop, because all the talks are being excellent, and we are all learning a lot of limits of diversity in ecological communities. So it's a pleasure for me being invited to you. Today I'm going to talk about how can theory explain.
Jose, sorry to interrupt you. We are seeing the presenter view. Can you put it into the?
Sorry.
How do you call it?
Yeah. I know. So it's kind of sorry.
Maybe if you just share your screen and then you just put it in the mode.
That would be
presentation mode.
Now
that's better. Yeah, that's better. Sorry. That's better?
Okay, fantastic. Sorry. what I was saying. Yeah. The purpose of my talk is going to be kind of investigating a little bit of how can theory tell something about the limits of diversity in ecological communities. Can we have some theoretical predictions under simplifying assumption? This is kind of related to the ideas that guy put forward in his talk before. Can we make some simplifications in our models to get some hint of how diversity can be predicted in under some certain settings? This is kind of the first slide I used to introduce the topic. As species diversity is huge. There are a lot of species reported around the world, and it is assumed that 80% of the species are still undiscovered. So this huge amount of diversity needs a well-grounded theoretical explanation. So this is puzzling because what theory tells us about diversity is just the opposite. All of you know this complexity stability trade-off, which was put forward by Robert May in 1972, when he challenged the view that ecological communities are diverse, which is puzzling because we observe that ecological communities are really diverse. He just took a Jacobian matrix of a local cultural dynamics, distributed with random interactions with a given variance, and some sort of connectance, which tells you the linkage density, and showed that using elementary random matrix theory, that there is an upper bound on the diversity that the ecological community can accommodate. So. Our intention in doing this, the work that I'm going to present is try to find an explanation of why do we see this overwhelming diversity in ecological communities, and what are the limits that these theoretical models can set to the number of species that we observe. Until like 10 years or 10 years before, the idea of studying stability in ecological communities was just considering the whole set of species as coexisting together, and there were a lot of studies studying the stability and the feasibility of the equilibrium points of a given dynamics, but considering the whole set of species as the assembled community. As you can imagine, the probability that this whole set of species, the pool, for example, is feasible is really negligible. So in this talk, I'm trying to change the perspective, which is kind of something that is has been commented in the talks before. Here I'm going to change the perspective in the sense that the species that survive, that we observe in local communities, are basically a selected portion of the species pool, which actually has been pruned by a certain population dynamics. So the question that I'm going to try to answer in my talk is whether we can predict the distribution of the number of species that survive when we assemble the community from a pool of species that in principle interact randomly. I'm not going to make any assumption of how the interactions are, if whether they are safe, whether they show patterns. We take this simplified null model perspective that Guy was commenting in his talk. And I'm interested in predicting the distribution of the number of species in the minimal setting that one can imagine. So we are going to talk about top-down species assembly here. I'm going to put all species together and let the dynamics unfold. And I will analyze, I will discuss here two examples. One where the when the interactions are basically random, and then when you consider phylogenies to generate the interactions. So if you have questions up to this point, I cannot see the chat at this moment, but if you're... Sorry?
No questions for now. I will let you know, Jose.
Fantastic method, thank you. The first part of the talk is what we call the random soup problem, which is work done in collaboration with Carlos Cerván and Stefano Alesina from the University of Chicago. Also, Jacopo Grilli was a key part of this collaboration when I was visiting the University of Chicago in 2017. Also, Ken Morrison collaborated. I give you here the reference if you are interested. So, why do we call this the random soup problem? Well, consider the following thought experiment. Consider that you take a large zoo, and at some point you open all the cages. If we were to come back after like 10 years, 20 years, can we predict how many species would still coexist in the zoo? To put it in another way, this would be kind of the outcome of when at some point Noah opens his ark after well, you know this story, right? So this is the idea. We are considering, we put this metaphor in this term because we are considering basically random interactions. So the mathematical setting of the problem is that we take basically lockable thermodynamics with variability in principle in growth rates, also variability in random interaction. I don't know whether you can see my pointer. Yeah.
Yes.
Fantastic. This would be the general setting. How can we compute the average number of species that one expects to observe after the community has reached to an equilibrium? Well, for doing that, we have to make some assumptions. Our strong assumption is this Lyapunov diagonal stability. We will assume, and this has some of this is kind of related to the talk by Guy, because well, we are here, we're considering that the dynamics has only just one single attractor. This can be achieved by assuming that our interaction matrix, this matrix of interaction of the lockable thermodynamics, is such there exists a diagonal matrix D such that this combination is definite, negative definite, right? In this case, and this is not so strong because you can always satisfy this condition by letting these self-regulation terms being large enough, right? Okay, if this condition is satisfied, there is a theorem by Hofbauer and Siegmund that it guarantees you that for every vector of rates, there is a single globally stable equilibrium point of the dynamics. So we are in a setting then that we can characterize, if we study the properties of this single equilibrium point, we can characterize the ecological community totally, right? So the characteristics of this equilibrium point is that it is not invasible by the remaining n minus chi species, right? I mean, if only K species survive in the community, the other species in the pool cannot invade the equilibrium. These two conditions, the feasibility of the equilibrium and the non-invasibility of the equilibrium, can help to understand the size of the attractor and the distribution of species that survive, and which is basically what I'm interested in. So here I mentioned this paper by Carlos and Stefano, where I'm interested in a top-down assembly process by just putting all the species together. In this case, it is easy to see that the sequential assembled community would be the same. But there are many conditions in this paper. I recommend you to look at it that give you necessary and sufficient conditions in which top-down and bottom-up assembly are the same. So our setting is interaction metrics are basically a diagonal metric, a mean term, and a random part. Right, which has kind of mean zero, and vector rates are have this mean and a kind of a variability. So to characterize this saturated fixed point, we just need to impose the two conditions that that define the saturated point, which is basically the feasibility and the non-invasibility. Feasibility is basically that the if we order the species as the one that survived here in the first place, the feasibility condition is basically that this submatrix times this vector plus the vector of rates is equal to zero. So this satisfies the equilibrium condition. For the non-impassibility, the species rates shouldn't grow when rare. So this translates in this submatrix times this green vector plus the remaining part of the vector of rates is equal to a vector that is negative. So a species, the remaining species in the pool cannot invade when rare. I'm going to speak about two cases. The first case within this random sub problem is the case of mean zero. In this case, we can calculate with very simple symmetry arguments the distribution of the species that survive. In this case, we consider arbitrary interactions with mean zero and arbitrary growth rates also with mean zero. In this case, the distribution of a species that survive is basically a binomial with probability 1/2. Why is this? Well, first you can analyze feasibility. The feasibility property is kind of intuitive, right? Because which is the probability that out of n, you can get n species surviving, right? This is basically 1/2 to the n. This is kind of intuitive, which is the probability that all species relay in this quadrant. If I take interactions randomly, well, you have basically to solve a system of two equations, a linear system of two equations with two unknowns, and the probability of laying in this quadrant is kind of intuitive to be 1/2, 1/4, right? So you can prove that the probability of feasibility is 1/2 to the n in this case of mean zero. And similarly, by a symmetry argument, you can also calculate that the probability of this equilibrium point to be is feasible and non-invasible is basically this probability, the probability that n-k species cannot invade condition that k survive times the probability that this k species are feasible. This conditional probability is basically equal to 1/2 to the n-k because any sign pattern for this vector is equally likely. It is simple to see that. So multiplying this result times the other result, you get that the probability is 1/2 to the n times the combinatorial factor because species can be arranged, can be sorted in this number of combinations, right? So basically we get the binomial distribution in the case of mean zero, which is kind of unrealistic from the ecological point of view. Can we say something about the case of non-zero mean? Well, in this case, we just chose the simplest scenario where we were able to do the calculation up to the end, which was basically considering that species rates are normally distributed. We include randomness in growth rates, right? But we switch off the random part in the interactions, right? So we not consider random interactions and allow variability for growth rates. I'm not going to give all the details, but we can, as in the mean zero case, we can calculate here the distribution of species that survive. To give a hint of how the calculation proceeds, basically you just take the probability distribution of the rates, which is a product of Gaussians. You just only have to perform this change of variables, right? Change the errors into the x and into the c, into the vector c, right? If you do this change of variable, which is very simple, then you only have to compute the probability that this vector x has all its components positive and this vector c has all its terms negative, which is basically this thing, right?
I think we have some raised hand. Can you take a question?
I was fixated on a little detail I might have missed. The heart of what you were saying, but are you a priori assuming global stability and just imposing some kind of sign structure?
No. I am assuming a global stability, right? Mm-hmm. This is something that I'm assuming in the dynamics. So I'm assuming that matrix A satisfy this condition. There exists this diagonal matrix that this combination is definite negative, but what I was saying about this sign combination is that all the sign combinations for this vector, for the C vector and the X vector, are equally likely, right? You can, if you think a little bit about that, you realize that all the sign combinations are equally likely, right? This gives you a probability of 1/2 raised to the number of elements that you have, or to the number of entries that your vector has. Okay.
So then we don't necessarily know what the interaction structure looks like. We're just keeping it arbitrary, or just
here I am assuming any distribution with the restriction that the mean is zero, basically, right?
And that. I mean, but how do we know that implies global stability? Other than, of course, that condition, the diagonality.
You can incorporate diagonal stability by just setting the self-regulation large enough in order to get the stability, right?
Okay.
So you can some plug in into the dynamics. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
So so after doing this calculation, which is a cumbersome calculation, you can get an analytical prediction of the mode of the distribution, which is basically related by this equation to model parameters. This Q star would be the fraction of species that survive. I mean, the number of species that survive divided by the size of the pool. And this is an analytical prediction that can serve as a null model to test something about coexistence in problems that can be related to this system. Here I show some results about the fully connected network, because we can kind of, once we have the prediction of the expected diversity, we can kind of complicate the model or add some ingredients to the null approach. by, for example, considering a network structure. In the case of we do not consider network structure, we have a very nice prediction of the number of species that survive. In this case, the distribution is no longer binomial. And then you can have regions where the expected number of species is very large and regions where the number of expected species is really, really low. Okay. But the key point here, or the idea I'm trying to transmit here, is that we can find an analytical predictions that an analytical prediction that can serve for further model testing or to compare with real systems. In the case that you impose some network pattern, I mean, this is basically introducing a connectance structure, a pattern of zero entries of the matrix in the model, right? And we can do it by introducing Erdos-Renyi degree distribution, power law degree distribution, or some bipartite or modular structure. And if we do this and compare with our analytical prediction, we have that the network has really a moderate effect in the prediction for the diversity, right? Because the full line is basically the analytical prediction for the fully connected network. Okay, so maybe I can stop here because. Sorry, no. Sorry. Okay, because I'm going to talk about the effect of phylogeny. I don't know if there are some questions or someone has something to ask.
I don't see questions in the chat. If someone has a question, you can raise hand or unmute yourself before we go into this next section. Jose, I think you can continue for now. Thank you.
Thank you. In this second part, I'm going to do the same stuff, something similar, but I'm not going to consider that interactions are fixed as in the previous random soup problem. I'm going to consider the effects of phylogeny, which will be a way to introduce variability in interactions in the model, right? This is a work done in collaboration also with Stefano and Carlos, and also with Zach from all of them from the University of Chicago. And I refer you to this reference where we can see the details of the things I'm going to summarize here. Well, the idea here is just can we say something about the limits that are imposed to diversity when you impose a phylogenetic structure in the community, or when interactions are inherited by kind of a phylogenetic structure. For that purpose, we start with a phylogenetic tree. Assume that you have a pool of five species here, and for example, you have this perfectly hierarchical tree. This gives you a correlation between the species given by the covariance matrix of the tree. And we formulate the interactions in terms of traits. Okay, we consider that at this point of the tree, each trait, in order to calculate the trait of each species, is basically a random walk on the leaves, right? Or basically a random walk on the tree. This basically gives you that the vector of traits is a multivariate normal distribution whose correlation matrix or whose covariance matrix is basically the covariance matrix of the tree. Okay, so if we consider L traits, we have this G matrix, which was also mentioned by Guy in his talk, and we just take as a measure of the interaction between species the shared overlap between the vector of traits. So we have this sample covariance matrix A equal to 1 over L GG transposed, as the way we are going to introduce the interactions in our model. If the vector of trace is basically a multivariate normal, then the sample covariance method follows the Wisard distribution, right? Depending on the parameters n, which is the size of the pool, l is the number of traces, and sigma is the correlation of the tree. So we basically do the same thing as before. We do top-down assembly. In this case, things are kind of simple because A is symmetric and positive definite. So this means that all the eigenvalues are positive, right? This immediately gives you diagonal stability. We have not, we don't have to impose diagonal stability on in this case. So you consider lockable thermodynamics. In this setting, we are assuming that fitness differences are absent. We assume that all species grow at the same rate. In terms of this Chesonian paradigm, we are interested in considering like competitive ability differences, right? In the iterations, we are kind of switching off fitness difference in order to get the picture more tractable. So in principle, you can consider also a mean, and then you have this lockable thermodynamics as in the case before. Notice the difference in design here, because this is not important. But so since we have a global stability, we can characterize the number of coexisting species by feasibility and non-invasibility. We can see simply that this mean interaction does not affect species identities, and also basically the vector of rates rescales biomasses, so we can remove them from the dynamics, and then we have top-down assembly and we are reaching a unique endpoint. Okay, what are my diversity predictions with this model? Well, first I'm going to consider the deterministic limits. I also want to mention that this model can be also recast in terms of a MacArthur consumer resource model. So all the things I'm going to say here about the number of traits, L can be translated immediately on a number of resources, which could be L as well in a MacArthur model. Okay, so in the deterministic limit, we consider that the number of traits is very large compared to the size of the pool. In this case, the sample covariance tends to the covariance of the tree. So it is simple to show in this case that every covariance metric induced by a tree yields full feasibility. We cannot worry about in this limit about feasibility because it is guaranteed. The idea is simple as I try to sketch by this diagram. Basically, if you have a tree with this shape, you can show that the covariance matrix of the full tree is basically this block matrix, which this sigma one is basically the covariance matrix of this subtree and so on, plus this constant term, which is related to the time to the first split of the tree. So if this each block is feasible, then by induction you get simply that the full tree would yield feasibility. This is a very strong result, right? So you don't have to worry about feasibility. There are also some predictions about total biomass and the abundance distribution. In order to get things tractable, we consider the limit of a perfectly hierarchical tree and a perfectly balanced tree, right? So we have predictions of the total biomass and the number of and the abundance distribution. For example, in the case of the total biomass, you can see that the biomass scales basically with the square root of the number of species that you can have in the tree. In order to compare with an empirical phylogeny, we consider here the Senna phylogenetic tree. And we see that we basically took subsamples of the tree in order to get this increase in number n. And we basically observed that the empirical tree is basically kind of in the middle of this perfectly hierarchical and the perfectly balanced, right? But in the deterministic limit, most of the things are easily predictable. We also can ask ourselves what is the prediction for a general result. I'm not, of course, going to enter into a full detail, but using the properties of the Wiesner distribution, you can calculate basically expressions for the probability of feasibility and the probability of non-invasibility. And these are the expressions, which are basically an integral over the key square distribution times the probability of a multivariate distribution over a certain condition. And the probability of non-invasibility is the same, and this is the probability that a given multivariate normal distribution is contained in a negative orphan. So in principle, this result gives you the exact probability of feasibility and non-invasibility, and in principle, this can be computed numerically, right, to a certain accuracy. Also, you can show that these two probabilities are independent of each other. So the probability of being on an attractor factorizes, and you have the probability that the attractor has size M. Okay. So again, can have this theoretical prediction if we consider a simple case, which is the case of a star phylogeny. The case of a star phylogeny is basically that you have a point that every species split and no more. In this case, we can carry out all these integrations and all this stuff, and we can have a prediction for the number of species that survive in average. This is the relation. This reminds the experimental result that Martina showed in the first stat on Tuesday, because this gamma is basically the number of traits or the number of resources, if you think of this in a MacArthur consumer resource setting. And we observe that the number of resources, as the number of resources increase, the average fraction of species that you observe is an increasing function, right? Dots are simulations and lines are our analytical prediction. This is interesting because the prediction of the competitive exclusion would be here in gamma at gamma equal to one, when the number of resources is equal to the number of species. And our theory predicts that the expected number of species is well beyond to what classical theoretical competitive exclusion predicts, okay? So we have fully characterized the diversity, as in the other case, we have regions where the diversity increases to a high level. Basically, the idea is if you increase the number of traits in the limit of infinite number of traits, which is basically the deterministic limit, you get full coexistence. And also, if you increase correlation between traits, then this is opposite to coexistence. Also, we have predictions
for the... Sorry, Jose. Maybe, I don't know, because we started a little bit late, but Jacobo, if I'm correct, you don't have a lot of time left. Do you have a lot to show?
No, I'm finishing. I have two slides, Mercedes. Okay. Fantastic. Yes, I just wanted to show how the total biomass depends on the number of resources, on the number of traits. We find a good agreement with simulations. And it's a decreasing function. It is because kind of the biomass splits into it kind of divides into the set of traits that you have into the number of traits. So this is it. I hope I've convinced you that under some simplifying assumptions, you can do some interesting predictions on the diversity, even related to the distribution of the number of coexisting species, assuming top-down assembly in these two meaningful situations. In this case, I have studied these two models when I have analyzed the variability in rates and also the variability in interaction. So in this case, these two approaches are kind of complementary. we now have a null expectation of how many species should coexist, and we can use it to probe the effect of other mechanisms in coexistence. So this is basically the idea on carrying out these ugly calculations. So extensions, we can introduce, for example, in networks patterns, for example, modularity, not yet in the position of the non-zero elements of the networks, also introducing patterns in the strengths, which have in the past have been shown to strongly stabilize or destabilize the system. Related to the talk by Guy, it would be interesting to relax all the assumption that we impose on diagonal stability and consider multiple attractors. And basically this is all I wanted to say. I want to thank all my collaborators. Most of them are in this picture. Also is Dan here. Jacopo is not in this picture because he was precisely taking the photo. So thank you very much for your attention. I'm happy to answer any question you may have.